thrilled to have with us today Ralph Merkle. And I'm going to give a little bit of the background here, but Ralph can expand on that himself. I met Ralph through, obviously, Singularity University, where he was our track chair for nanotech and molecular machines. That's his kind of current claim to fame, and has been doing a lot of work around that, which we'll talk about. But really, the big, most important claim to fame is the concept of Merkle hash trees, which is the basis of cryptography and, frankly, the one-way hashing that leads to cryptocurrencies. And he's one of our key advisors in this world. And the third part I want to cover today is really Ralph, your thinking around how do we think about governance and DAOs, because we want to aim our world and our ecosystem in that direction. And what problems would that solve? So let's start with this. Give us a kind of a little snapshot of your background, so people have a sense of the breadth that you've been operating at. And then I want to delve into a couple of the topics specifically.
Well, as you probably know, I was involved in cryptography in various ways. I started out at Merkle and cooked up public key cryptography as a quarter project because I was supposed to do it for a security course and my prof didn't find that interesting. So I took off to Stanford where there was this guy called Hellman who did find it interesting. So I pursued it there and there was some interest in that. So in my PhD thesis, I described what are now called Merkle trees, and it turns out that was a good idea. So it's now widely recognized as a good idea. So that's nice. And it involves hash functions and compression functions and things like that applied in the structure of a tree so that you can authenticate large structures conveniently. And then you can authenticate a single leaf in a large structure conveniently. And that turns out to be a very useful thing to do in a variety of applications, which is kind of what I thought when I cooked it up. Looks, and then others since then have said, yeah, that looks convenient. Well, I could actually look it up and be exact, but it's somewhere in the vicinity of 1979. And then I think 76, I was actually taking the course. So that would be, you know, somewhere in that ballpark. But the 70s.
We're like 40 years ago where encryption in that sense was created. And it's taken us that long to figure it out.
Yeah.
So see the real world, broader applications of it.
Yeah.
Which tend to be consistent with your work. In inventions.
Yeah.
It takes like a few decades for it to get realized.
My timing is horrible.
Well, I'm going to share my screen for a second, and I want to show the audience this image, which is actually the genesis hash of our blockchain, of our cryptography blockchain. And at the bottom there, you see the Merkle hash of the genesis block of our blockchain.
Cool.
So super thrilled. You can imagine my excitement when I saw that. And I was like, wow, this is so great. So I'm double thrilled. Okay, so you've gone from cryptography to now your main focus is nanotechnology. Mm-hmm. And you're looking specifically at computing using molecular machines.
Yes.
Which will probably take 20, 30 years also to
realize. Yeah, it looks like it's gonna take a while to do that.
Give us a quick framing for the audience of where we end up with that, because I want to have no illusions as to how big of an implication that is when we realize it. So,
well, a lot of people are saying Moore's law is going to run into a brick wall, and I sort of looked at that a few years ago and said, hey, the reason Moore's law is going to have problems is heat. And if you look at the heat problem, you start to realize that you need to develop computational systems that don't dissipate as much heat, which means they have to be a lot smaller and a lot more efficient. So basically, I've been working on thermodynamically reversible molecular computational elements, and we've been publishing papers that say, hey, here's an atomically precise design for a thermodynamically reversible computational element that's mechanical, harbaging back to Babbage. You remember that guy?
Sure.
So we've analyzed it rather carefully, and we've concluded that, you know, we can stretch this Moore's law thing for another 10 or more orders of magnitude without pushing it too hard.
So hold on a second. My degree is in theoretical physics. And when you say thermodynamically reversible, that just broke my brain. Right? So can you delve into that just for my, because it's a closed system, you can go thermodynamically reversible? Is that what you're saying?
Yep. So basically, normal computers, when you compute something, you erase bits. And it turns out erasing bits requires, for fundamental physics reason, natural log 2 times kT, where K is Boltzmann's constant and T is the temperature, typically in kelvins, and log 2 is the logarithm of the number 2. And that's sort of fundamental. And if you want to erase a bit, you're kind of stuck with that. And most of today's computers erase bits with prodigious fluency. They just do it all over the place. And if you want to design a computer that doesn't constantly erase bits in the course of its normal operation, that takes some effort. And if you want to do it in a way that's actually very efficient, because not only do you have to not erase bits in a logical sense, you also have to design the system so that physically it's also very efficient, that's hard. And so you start designing a system where it does this. And to do this, we developed a system that involves molecular rotary joints, where the molecular rotary joints are single bonds. So if you imagine two molecular groups rotating around a single bond, that doesn't dissipate very much energy. And all of the computations involve molecules rotating around single bonds. So it was necessary to develop a way of computation that just involved molecules rotating around single bonds, and then that would dissipate very little energy. And then it had to be done in a way that was thermodynamically reversible so that there were no bits being erased anywhere. And then the whole thing is very clever, and we wrote a paper, and it's all very marvelous. And at some point, we'll be able to build it. And then we get another 10 orders of magnitude in Moore's law.
Can we share that paper as a link in the interview? We'll paste it in.
Sure.
Because our community would love to read it, and certainly some of them would love to see, at least to get a grasp of what's involved.
Yep.
But so help me with the granularity of this. Essentially, what you're doing is representing a bit and a binary digit now as a molecular bond.
It's in the rotational conformation of a couple of molecules that are connected by molecular bonds. So as they change their rotational conformation with respect to each other, that encodes a bit of information.
Got it. And so now the basis of computation is either coding or one or zero, and then reading the one or zero. Can you also read with very little energy dissipated?
Well, as long as you're internally within the system, yes, you can read and write, and it's all very wonderful. Okay. As you go out of the system, if you have a display that a human can look at, humans are very large, and if you want to have a display that a human can look at, you have to emit a lot of light or something like that. And then, you know, all bets are off. But that's right. Okay. That comes at the end of the computation.
Sure. Just the core encoding, if we can reduce that to the molecular level.
Exactly.
So when we talk about Internet of Things, we're really talking about Internet of molecular bonds, to be precise, in this equation.
In that model of computation, yes.
And does this new model, assuming it's realizable and your inventions have been realizable over decades?
If you wait a while, yes.
what kind of orders of magnitude? You set up to 10 more orders of magnitude, but it yeah. sounds way more because effectively may go 10 more orders of magnitude, but the energy requirements, the footprint requirements, the manufacturing requirements all kind of disappear largely, right?
Pretty much, yeah. The size goes down. I mean, obviously, if you've got molecular size gates, you can get a lot of computational power into a very small volume.
Yeah.
But then most of the effort was in the heat dissipation, because if you look at modern computers, you find that heat is the big enemy.
Yeah.
And I think most people will agree who are, you know, designing computers, their day-to-day enemy in sort of big computers, big iron, or even your desktop computer is, what do we do with the heat? We're
yeah.
generating too much heat. It's going to fry the components unless we're careful. That's what you have to deal with. And so driving that heat down by 10 orders of magnitude would really help.
Yeah, hugely. So that totally changes the computing paradigm, and we go from transistors to some level of quantum computing, which I'm assuming you have the same view that...
Well, the quantum computing is another issue. I mean, that one, yes, we're going to have quantum computers as well, but that's separate from the, let's take classical computers and right. make them dissipate less heat.
Yep.
Because quantum computers at this point, there are a couple of tasks we know quantum computers are really good at.
Right.
And then there's a lot of things where we're kind of scratching our heads saying, well, who knows if the quantum computers really help us at that sort of thing. We're not quite sure yet. But yep. there are a couple of things where they're really good, therefore we'll develop the quantum computers. And then later on, we'll see if they're good for other stuff as well. I mean, right now, it looks like quantum computers will be specialized sort of niche things that you build for, you know, the couple of applications they're good for, and then you have your conventional computer doing most of the stuff that you want to have done and for setting up the quantum computers. Now that picture might change. People might discover that you can do all kinds of interesting things with quantum computers, or then again they might not. So we'll just have to see how that plays out.
You're pursuing this line because it sounds like your opinion is that the most effective way to continue the Moore's law curve and the paradigm of computing is the solving the heat dissipation problem, which the molecular bonds do to a decent extent.
Exactly.
Got it.
Okay. And basically, we're going to we have pretty much hit a wall in terms of heat, and yeah. then we're in the process of hitting a wall in terms of manufacturing using the current sort of lithographic.
Hey, yeah, we're down to a few nanometers. Where are things?
Yeah, things are beginning. People are beginning to make noises about, you know, how can we keep going?
Right. And
the answer is we're going to have to change. I mean, you know, we've gone from relays to vacuum tubes to transistors to integrated circuits to large scale integrated circuits to whatever it is you want to call it that we're doing now. I mean, we've jumped from technology to technology.
Yeah.
And the fact that we've pushed the current technology as far as we have is really quite remarkable.
Yeah.
So it shouldn't come as any surprise to anyone that, hey, let's shift to another technology.
Right. Very cool. So now let me shift back to the cryptography stuff, because I want to talk a little bit about back when you were working on Merkle hashes at the time. Did you actually see the application spaces at the time, or did you kind of guess at them? There was a couple of them, and then you go, well, you know, if this gets properly implemented, this is where we get to.
Well, I mean, obviously, I didn't see the wide range of things that people would be doing. I sort of guessed that it would be useful for stuff, and there were one or two obvious applications that sort of were clear. And then, hey, it looks useful, right? I mean, the intuition is this looks useful. Let's try and develop this and make sure that it gets into people's heads that here's a nice idea. And then after that, hey, you know, I'm sorry, I didn't predict all of this stuff.
Right.
I sort of had a vague idea that it would develop, and then, you know, things would happen.
I love the approach, Dick, but except your work has almost always resulted in massive industries being created 2-3 decades down the line. So this is just has taken a slightly longer time frame than that. I mean, as you talk about it, there's no way we don't end up with molecular computing in the way you've defined it. It's the only real
path. Yeah, that's pretty much it. I mean, the whole molecular manufacturing, molecular computation, yeah, it's inevitable. And then if you want to, you know, draw the straight lines on semi-log paper, that's pretty much the classical way of getting a handle on the timing.
Right.
So.
Okay. So now let's move from, you know, we've talked about the cryptography. We have this incredible capability now with blockchain and with Bitcoin and the tokenized world. I would love if you could spend a couple of minutes summarizing the paper that you wrote, and we'll put a link to the paper titled Democracies, DAOs, and Governance. It really changed my worldview as to what was possible. And we're actually aiming our ecosystem pretty much straight at that paper in terms of the way we're looking to see this thing implemented, which is why I'm so thrilled that you've agreed to chat about it. So give us a quick summary for the people watching as to what's covered in that paper and what you're hoping to say is possible.
Well, there are a couple of perspectives on it. I think the simplest perspective is, gee, we would like to have stable governance. And stable governance would be, you know, really useful. Anyone who looks at the world today and looks at the governance that we have among nations and corporations and other such things is going to be, you know, saying, hey, stable governance would be a good idea. You know, that would be kind of nice. And if you look at sort of how it is that governance takes place, you start to say, you know, there are issues with our current governance. Could we imagine something that was sort of an overall better system? And there have been ideas kicking around about how to engage in governance. Some of those ideas involve prediction markets and how to get prediction markets to better enable a sort of a market-based mechanism for making decisions, how to aggregate information. And then you also have questions of how do you reliably carry out the decision-making function. There's some argument that people are perhaps not as reliable as we might like. It might be better if you had some mechanism that was more reliable in the process of making decisions. Obviously, one of the things is if you look at Bitcoin and you look at the cryptographic mechanisms underlying it, you say, you know, those are pretty reliable. Bitcoin's been chugging along for a long time now.
Yeah.
And the core mechanism, I mean, despite the ups and downs of sort of the peripheral ecology around it, sort of the exchanges and things where people have had issues, the core mechanism has been quite astonishingly reliable.
Yeah.
And when you look at that, you start to say things like, gee, I wish we had governance mechanisms based on such a very reliable system. And that system provides you with a trust model which extends throughout the world, which allows you to have a core mechanism which is very reliable. And then if you start to say, you know, these prediction market things seem to provide a mechanism for making decisions which looks very good, certainly if you compare the quality of the decisions they seem to be able to make compared with some of the current decision-making processes, and then you say, hey, this looks very reliable in terms of the mechanisms, the underlying mechanisms, they seem to be cryptographically secure, let's stir that all together and see if we can come up with something. And let's, you know, engage in research on current concepts, stir them all together and see if we can put them together in a package that looks attractive. And that's sort of the DAO democracy. The question is, how do you sort of take democracy as it exists today and imagine a combination of ways of putting it together so that you have something which is based on the reliability of sort of the Bitcoin concepts. It brings in sort of the prediction market aggregation of ideas mechanisms that pulls in some of the governance concepts that have been talked about in, for example, Futarchy, pulls them together, stirs them into sort of a single concept and says, let's do this. And then, of course, because it's, I mean, you know, you talk about, I cook up ideas that take a long time to implement. This one's going to take an even longer time because it involves, you know, people and getting ideas put together about governance and getting people to accept new ideas about governance. So it's it looks like it's going to take an even longer time scale because it involves looking at ideas that are different about governance.
So I'm gonna challenge that with two thoughts. One is, it seems pretty clear with the way the world is going that we don't have that much time. If nothing else, what's happening with climate change, our policies are not dealing with that effectively in any way, real way. So that's one. And secondly, you know, we've done a lot of work over the last 5 years on breaking the immune system problem and solving that problem. How do you get new ideas implemented into the world? And because you have to we have a ton of new ideas, but getting them implemented,
yes,
you have to get through the legacy backlash and the Luddite revolt or the conservative structures or market structures or incentive mechanisms or whatever. And we've actually been working on that part. So the EXO sprint that we devised and also what we call Fast Track is able to take a public policy environment and blow it open in 16 weeks and totally transform it.
Good.
Now, if you marry that with the aspirational characteristics of what you've talked about, there is actually the possibility. So we're going to actually start a pilot soon with about 10 cities where we want to start trying to implement this. So good. That's actually very real. We'll see if we can shrink the implementation by orders of magnitude. That will be my personal challenge as you envision this. I want to make a little leap that you may have made a connection for me, which is that when you think about policy making with prediction markets, policies are basically decisions by the collective on how we should govern, right? So an election is basically a prediction market in this concept.
In some sense, one of the core concepts in DAO democracy was to separate the intellectual task of figuring out what's going on, you know, which politician is lying, which politician is telling the truth, which policies look like they're good ideas, which policies look like they're bad ideas, separating that intellectual analysis from the, hey, I don't like that. I have a visceral feeling when I'm involved in that that's bad, or I have a visceral feeling that that's good. Because what happens too much of the time is you're in the current structure of democracy, you're asking, you know, Joe Blow to make complex decisions about, well, you know, we have alternative economic decisions that need to be evaluated on a complex criteria of, Joe Blow doesn't know what's going on. Yeah. So you've got to present Joe Blow with something that's simple, and then you have to factor out the complex decision-making and hand that to people who are very knowledgeable. And here's the nub of it. Typically, when you hand decision-making to very bright people, they promptly lie, steal the system, and loot it. Right. I mean, that's what happens.
Right.
The big problem is, how do you get really bright people to make the decisions, but structured in such a way that they can't put their hands into the cookie jar?
Yep.
And that was the problem. And I think, you know, as near as I can figure out, I've rigged it so it does it in a way that works. And I'll tell you some of the sort of the driving motives. One of the driving motives was exactly what you were describing, which is technology is racing ahead. And when I looked down, you know, into my crystal ball, I said, you know, we're going to have a lot of technological things going on. We need better ways of making decisions so that complex issues can be dealt with effectively, or, you know, we're going to make what one might call suboptimal decisions. That looks like a strong driving force. Huge. In order to, yeah, exactly. So
we frame it as we have 20 Gutenberg moments hitting us all at the same time today in the form of blockchain, solar energy, autonomous cars, drones. I mean, if half of your work gets implemented, there's like six of them right in there. And so our ability to absorb that as society is terrible today.
Exactly. So how do we deal with that? How do we make decisions that are going to be able to cope with that in a way that makes sense?
So let's run through a specific example. So give me an example of a policy area that you could drive, use with the prediction markets to drive with to a decision. And then what does the implementation look like in that policy area so that you don't have corruption implemented?
Well, let's take, for example, climate change. Everyone's worried about climate change. How would you deal with climate change? And one of the things you see in climate change is there actually are technological areas which should be pushed hard. And you have to make technical decisions about, you know, which things should be addressed. Where should we put the research dollars? And that shows up in research in areas outside of climate change. In other words, typically what you do in research is you go to a bunch of research scientists and you say, research scientists, we don't understand what you're doing. Here's a pile of money, form committees and spend it. And the decision-making process is something along the lines of, ooh, I think that's pretty. Let's give him lots of money. I don't know what he's doing and he's out of fashion. Let's not give him money. And there's no sort of linkage to anything that's interesting. So what you want to do is link the research dollars to things that people care about, like climate change or food or the water supply, or, you know, pick some of the major issues that are going on. And you want to link it in a way where there's sort of a clear driving force that says, you know, if this research in this complex area that, you know, 10 people on the planet understand, if this research area is valuable for dealing with the problem, let's put a ton of money into it.
Right. If we pick a subtopic of climate change, which would be carbon sequestration, right, and carbon recapture. What you're saying is you get together a group of the key people in the space or people that understand what that means. They kind of make a prediction markets type of voting system on how much effort should, or how important is that topic relative to others. And then some sort of smart contract then allocates research dollars to those types of activities broken down. Is that
right? And then you have to sort of make decisions about, here is one area we could do, and here is a wildly disparate area.
Yeah.
And how do you allocate resources between these two wildly disparate areas, and how do you take care of that? And then how do you do that across all of society? And I puzzled with that for a long time. And the eventual result in sort of the Dow Democracy paper was fairly simple. You just go around to everybody and you ask them to vote in a way which is very straightforward. Once a year, you ask them to, you know, give you a number between 0 and 1. So you're getting feedback. That's clearly, I guess it's clearly democratic in the sense that everybody provides you a number between 0 and 1, and then you add up all the numbers and divide by the number of people. And that's your sort of metric for everybody involved. And you just do that every year. And then you have a prediction market that tries to predict whether your actions today make that number go up or down. And then in some sense, that's a very easy thing for people to do. You know, if I ask you, hey, are you feeling better? Do you think things are going well? Give me a number between 0 and 1. Pretty much anyone can do that. And you don't ask them to predict the future or anything like that. You just say, hey, how are you feeling? And then you gather this data, and then you use the prediction markets to figure out whether your policy makes this number go up in 5-10 years or go down.
Right. And then the 0 to 1 is also good because you get a wisdom of crowds kind of effect
Bingo.
Topic, right? And which we know as a social structure works pretty well. So if you run that model, how do you deal with, say, national versus local politics?
Well, the one of the things going on with that model is there is a group from which you are gathering the data. So in other words, if you say, let's run that, I mean, you're picking, let's take 10 cities.
Yep.
So if you ran this model on 10 cities, you take the population of the 10 cities and you say, hey, the people in those 10 cities are the people from whom we take the data. And then the model will say, okay, I'm looking after the people in that 10 cities.
Yep.
And if you do that, then the model is going to try and make the world better for the people in those 10 cities.
Right.
So it's not going to look after the rest of the world. It's going to look after the people in the 10 cities.
Right.
And when you do that, it'll do, you know, horrible things like, hey, we've saved the people in 10 cities. Everyone else is dead.
Yep.
Because it just doesn't care about the rest of the world. So obviously what you want to do is extend the system until it covers everybody. And so that gets into the next level of the problem, which is how do you create a small system which grows?
Yeah.
And that's, you know, that gets into the, oh, you have a very nice vision there. What are the stages that are in place before you get to this wonderful vision of where everything is perfect? What are the stages by which we got there? And hopefully the stages by which we get there are, you know, there's 10 cities, there's 20 cities, there's 50 cities. And hopefully the structure is such that, you know, it inherently is structured so that it can grow in a very natural way. I mean, what happened with Bitcoin? Hmm. Bitcoin was just fired up and then suddenly it took off. So what was, you know, how was Bitcoin designed so that it would, you know, take off? Well, it did. So right. Maybe we look at the Bitcoin example and say, how was it that Bitcoin grew? And maybe that's one model for saying, how do you build something that's small and grows? Maybe
right.
That's not the only way of doing it, but certainly that is a model that took place and was successful.
Well, we're going to launch this pilot, and I think it'll be quite fascinating as we play with these different structures to see what works and what doesn't. What we're trying to do is create a very fast feedback loop so that we can
move
as quickly as possible and iterate quickly. I want to close this out by going to one of your favorite topics, and I want you to describe Alcor.
Cryonics, yes.
And why, and just to leave people with that as they go to their lunches or coffees after watching this. So let's give you the floor on Alcor for a couple of minutes and cryonics and why you believe strongly in that.
Well, it's pretty obvious. I mean, if you want to think about the future, then the next thing is, hey, I'd like to be there. I'd like to see what happens. I'd like to watch the technology grow. I'd like to participate. And besides which, being alive is fun. I mean, let's face it. That's just, come on. I mean, you know, that's just the long and the short of it. So yeah. One would like to live a longer and healthier life, and that would be great. So how do you do that with current technology? Well, the answer is you don't, because with current technology, you know, the body tends to deteriorate over time, and modern medicine can only go so far. And so what do you do about that? Well, the answer is, You look at where technology is going and you say, look, we're going to have this amazing medical technology of the future. We're going to have medical nanorobots that can cure and heal in the most hopeless of cases today. And oh, guess what? If you are cryopreserved, then we've preserved all of the tissue and the structures and all that. Admittedly, the system is not working, but oh, if you have molecular nanodevices, if you have medical nanorobots, they can restore unworking structures because the medical nanorobots can go in through the circulatory system. They can even go in through a cryopreserved circulatory system, much like tunneling, and then they can repair everything because they have the ability to examine and restore molecular structures. And at that point, suddenly you say, wait a minute, you mean I could be cryopreserved and wake up in the future that has all of this wonderful technical stuff going on? And the answer is, well, yeah. I mean, all you need is an organization that will cryopreserve you and keep you cryopreserved for a long enough period of time. And then all of the technology, which, you know, you can look up if you want to, because there are lots of articles and discussions, and you can start from my homepage if you want. But there's a lot of discussion of the kind of technologies that we're going to have over the coming decades. And don't forget, once you're at the temperature of liquid nitrogen, you can stay that way for centuries and nothing changes.
Right.
And then you wake up in the future and you get to join the group of us who are in the experimental group. And I recommend highly that you join the experimental group, because we know what's happening to the control group. Yes. I can state with high reliability the probability of survival of the control group.
Very nice. So what's your best guess in terms of something happens to me today and I've got a contract and we preserve me, drop me into liquid nitrogen, flush me out, et cetera, and now I'm kind of frozen for a bit. What's your best guess as to when I would be reawoken? When are the technologies ready? Is it 20, 30, 40, 50, 100 years? What's your best guess?
So I would say under 100 years, and then everyone is all over the map, because different people have different estimates based on their differing understanding of how rapidly future technology will be developed. And who cares? Alcor as an organization is devoted to making sure you stay in liquid nitrogen for however long it might take.
Right. And what's the cost?
Well, the cost is $80K for neuro and $200K for whole body. And then there's, you know, annual dues that are, I forget, several hundred dollars a year, $600-$700 a year, something on that order of magnitude. And then all you have to do is look up alcor.org on the web, and you'll find lots of information. And there's a FAQ.
Yep.
So you can get all of the answers to all of your questions about this. And I recommend highly that you, in fact, sign up, because it's pretty obvious that the alternative is more boring.
Wonderful. So we've covered today a wide range of topics, from molecular bond computing and solving the computing problem with reversible thermodynamics computation, to cryptography, your history there, to where we go with DAOs and governance, and some ideas there that we're actually passionate about implementing in our whole ecosystem, right down to, okay, what do we do with the future of your own self? I'm sure our community, we will be super thrilled to hear this stuff. Ralph, I would love to have a follow-up with you on a dozen of these, so we'll do that at some point.
But that sounds now, good.
Let's wrap it up here. Thank you so much for your time, and even more for the work that you're doing.
It's been my pleasure.
All right, Ralph Merkle, everyone. All right, we're going to leave it there. Ralph, okay. That was awesome.